Hello everyone. Today I'm going to finish off part two of that article. But first, the question is, why does Sam Vaknin write poetry? And he answers this question at healthyplace.com. I'll post the link in the description box below. They say, with a knowing smile, if he is really a narcissist, how come he writes such beautiful poetry? Words are the sounds of emotions, they add, and he claims to have none. They are smug and comfortable in their well-classified world, my doubters. But I use words as others use algebraic signs, with meticulousness, with caution, with precision of the artisan. I sculpt in words, I stop, I tilt my head, I listen to the echoes, the tables of emotional resonance, the fine-tuned reverberations of pain and love and fear, airwaves and photonic ricochets answered by chemicals secreted in my listeners and my readers. I know beauty. I have always known it in the biblical sense. It was my passionate mistress. We made love. We procreated the cold children of my texts. I measured its aesthetics admirably, but this is the mathematics of grammar. It was merely the undulating geometry of syntax. Devoid of all emotions, I watch your reactions with the sated amusement of a Roman nobleman. With that said, keep in mind Sam Vaknin has also been quoted as saying, narcissists use words as weapons. He has a whole video on it, I do believe. If I can find it, I'll put it in the link in the description box below. And I am back at samvaknin.wordpress.com when narcissists become codependent, part two of two. Now, what's interesting about this article is mostly about the victim. If you notice, it's all about the victim who encourages the sadism in the narcissist. And you'll see what I mean in a minute. I left off at the status of professional victim sits well with the partner's tendency to punish herself, namely with her masochistic streak. The tormented life with the narcissist is just what she deserves. I don't think anybody deserves a narcissist, that's for sure. If you're any sort of healthy person at all. Nobody deserves a narcissist. In this respect, the partner is the mere image of the narcissist. Now, also keep in mind that this is coming from a sadistic narcissist. This is how he perceives the victim, not how the victim perceives the narcissist and what they've been through. By maintaining a symbiotic relationship with him, by being totally dependent upon her source of masochistic supply, now he is suggesting that his partner, the narcissist's partner, is with the sadistic narcissist simply for masochistic supply. She enjoys being abused. Masochistic supply. Think about that. Yeah, which the narcissist most reliably constitutes and most amply provides. Oh boy, do they. The partner enhances certain traits and encourages certain behaviors, which are at the very core of narcissism. So now basically he's saying that the victim has all the same traits as the narcissist, just in the opposite direction. So now you have your sadist and your masochist. Not something I signed up for, that's for sure. Or knew what I was signing up for. The narcissist is never whole without an adoring, submissive, available, self-denigrating partner. His very sense of superiority, indeed his false self, depends on it. His sadistic superego switches its attention from the narcissist, in whom it often provokes suicidal ideation, to the partner, thus finally obtaining an alternative source of sadistic satisfaction. So I do believe he's talking about projective identification there, where the narcissist, of course, they can't feel their feelings, but they love to watch them in other people, making them a predator. Predators, just by nature, don't feel what their victim feels. Their victim is just lunch, right? If they felt what their victim felt, that would mean they had empathy. And if they had empathy, then they wouldn't be a predator, right? So now we go on to some more victim blaming. The partner enhances certain traits and encourages certain behaviors, which are at the very core of narcissism. Now, it's the victim's fault, right? Because if she didn't enhance certain traits and encourage certain behaviors, the narcissist wouldn't be raging at her, sabotaging her, controlling her, right? The narcissist is never whole without an adoring, submissive, available, self-denigrating partner. His very sense of superiority, indeed his false self, depends on it. His sadistic superego switches its attention from the narcissist, in whom it often provokes suicidal ideation, to the partner, thus finally obtaining an alternative source of sadistic satisfaction. Now, people who have been following my vlog saw the movie clip of Seven with the naive cop, police officer, and the serial killer, who was in control of the entire situation and provoked him into wrath so that he would kill the serial killer. That's what he wanted. The serial killer did. And if you watch the serial killer's expression as he's provoking, it's very peaceful because he doesn't have those feelings. Narcissists, psychopaths, they don't have a wide range of emotions. They are predators. And the emotions that they have are rage, envy, all of those things. But that's at the bottom, you know, the primitive emotional list, so to speak. And those are all pathological. The other ones have not evolved, developed, matured, anything like that. So as a predator, like a cat and a mouse, that cat's going to bat the mouse around curiously. Oh, isn't this fun? Look at how you're reacting. Flight, fight, or freeze. They're watching all of these reactions and provoking them in you because they don't have them, and they find it curious and funny that you do have those reactions. Because they don't have them, they will never have them, if that makes sense. So it is through self-denial that the partner survives. I wouldn't call it self-denial. No, I wouldn't. I would call it confusion. I would call it you don't know what the hell is going on, basically. It wasn't until 10, 15 years ago that personality disorders were even made public, really. She denies her wishes, hopes, dreams, aspirations, sexual, psychological, and material needs, choices, preferences, values, and much else besides. No, she doesn't deny them. The narcissist denies them. Now, remember the control freakery. A narcissist, once they have you trapped, they're going to take total control, sadistic control. And then what they're going to do is play with you like the cat and the mouse. It's funny to them. They like to see you in pain and suffering. She's not denying them. The narcissist is denying them of her after he's convinced her that he should be in control. So she perceives her needs as threatening because they might engender the wrath of the narcissist's godlike supreme figure. Okay, I'm just trying not to laugh here, right? Her needs are threatening because they are being threatened, and not because the narcissist is godlike. It's because behind her back, or the victim's back, he has taken control and now, without her knowing it, is raging at her, because this is what I've lived, whenever she asks for what she wants and needs. And he is in control. Shut her up and shut her down. You will submit. It's not about the victim. The victim is the one who doesn't know what the hell is going on. The two collaborate in this macabre dance. The narcissist is formed by his partner in so much as he forms her. I disagree completely. I was being shaped and molded into something and someone I was not. It was his fantasy version of a completely submissive, catatonic woman staring out the window. That's what he wanted, not me. And I fought him every step of the way. Submission breeds superiority and masochism breeds sadism. The relationships are characterized by emergentism. Roles are allocated almost from the start, and any deviation meets with an aggressive, even violent reaction. Well, of course. Of course. A cognitive distortion. For example, my narcissist would have confused the fact that I appreciate traditional roles in a marriage. Husband, wife, carving out those roles so that the house runs efficiently and children are raised properly, etc., etc. I'm not saying that's right for everyone. That's just how I was brought up. I've seen it work. And I would guess that my narcissist took that as being me being submissive or eventually being able to be made submissive. Traditional roles do not mean that the woman is submissive if she's staying home and taking care of the house and the cooking the meals and all that stuff. It doesn't mean that at all. It just means she's working for non-wages. And yeah, a bit of sacrificing done there. But if that's what you sign up for in the beginning, now, but a narcissist would misinterpret that as much as Sam Bachman is going to say that the victim misinterprets. It's the narcissist who's misinterpreting that, in my case anyway, in my example, traditional roles that I presumed and thought we were going to do as him being able to make me submit and submit even further down the road once he had me isolated. The predominant state of the partner's mind is utter confusion. Exactly. Yeah, he gets that part right because you don't know what they're doing. You're with a predator, a disorganized mind at best, right? Who is confusing the hell out of you, smoke and mirrors, lying while they're taking control, isolating you, presenting you with many different masks, raging at you, managing down your expectations. You are trapped. What choices do you have at some point except to run or fight or freeze? Even the most basic relationships with husband, children, or parents remain baffling, obscured by the giant shadow cast by the intensive interaction with the narcissist. No, it remained bafflingly obscured because he was triangulating everyone behind my back. Of course, that's how they do it. They get people fighting. They don't like to see people get along. And of course, that's baffling. And the way he writes, giant shadow cast by the intensive interaction with the narcissist, as if the narcissist is some kind of fucking super god here. No, they're a mess. They ruin everything. Anyway, a suspension of judgment is part and parcel of a suspension of individuality, which is both a prerequisite to the result of living with the narcissist. Well, if you're in freeze mode, you're confused, you don't know what the hell is going on, yes, your judgment will be suspended because you're trying to figure out what the hell is wrong with this guy. The partner no longer knows what is true and right and what is wrong and forbidden. And that would be because of all the gaslighting, lying, basically. The narcissist recreates for the partner the sort of emotional ambience that led to his own formation in the first place. Capriciousness, fickleness, arbitrariness, emotional and physical or sexual abandonment. The world becomes hostile and ominous, and the partner has only one thing left to cling to, the narcissist. Yeah. It does become hostile and ominous because behind your back, the narcissist has been running a smear campaign, sabotaging every part of your life to isolate you like a predator would. And the only person, if you don't know what's going on, what you're dealing with, what you've been married to, the monster that you've been married to, the only thing left to cling to is the narcissist. That's the whole idea. They want you to be the center of, or actually they are the center of your universe. You're not supposed to know any other reality but theirs. Enkling, she does. If there's anything which can safely be said about those who emotionally team up with narcissists, it is that they are overtly and overly dependent. No, I was made to be dependent. And then codependent. That's what he was going for. They do it all on purpose. The partner doesn't know what to do, and this is only too natural in the mayhem that is the relationship with the narcissist. Yeah, the chaos and drama. But the typical partner also does not know what she wants, and to a large extent, who she is and what she wishes to become. So not true. I knew exactly what I wanted. I knew exactly what I needed, and I had a plan for my life. And when we got married, a plan for our life. By the time the narcissist got done with me, in terms of scrambling my brain, because I didn't know what the hell was going on between the lying and the gaslighting and the smear campaign and the sabotaging. Even my car he has sabotaged. He thought I wouldn't figure that out. I woke up one morning going, what do I want? I don't know anymore because he's destroyed my life. So I have to start over everything. I can't go back at all and repair much of anything. And he did that on purpose. These unanswered questions hamper the partner's ability to gauge reality. Well, I hope I answered a few for you. and yeah, reality sucks when a narcissist gets done with you. Her primordial sin is that she fell in love with an image, not with a real person. It is the voiding of the image that is mourned when the relationship ends. The breakup of a relationship with a narcissist is therefore very emotionally charged. Yeah. You know why? Because once you figure out what they've been doing, you're really pissed off. Hey, you destroyed my life. I'm really not happy about that. Yeah, and then they deny it. Even when you give them proof. Even when they admit it to you 1 minute and then turn it around the next and say, I never said that. It is the culmination of a long chain of humiliations and of subjugation. That is done by the narcissist. Nobody signs up for this shit. It is the rebellion of the functioning and healthy parts of the partner's personality against the tyranny of the narcissist. That I'll agree with. The partner is likely to have totally misread and misinterpreted the whole interaction. I hesitate to call it a relationship. All right, what's wrong with this? What's wrong with this? We know that psychopaths and narcissists wear masks. They are a lie. Their whole entire being is a lie. So they lead you to misread and misinterpret. They reflect back to you, basically, in order to get you to fall in love with them. So how are you really misreading? You're being misled to misread. So it's really all on the narcissist, isn't it? This lack of proper interface with reality might be erroneously labeled pathological. So now he's calling the victim, again, this is the second time in this article, somehow have a lack of a proper interface with reality. But we don't want to call her pathological. Do you see the twisting here? This amazes me. He has now turned it around on the victim in an article about the narcissist as codependent. He's turned it around on the victim saying that, well, you know, the victim is really the masochist and she's seeking supply and she's encouraging all these behaviors in him and all his sadism is coming out and she really misread and misinterpreted all the lies that were supposed to mislead her so she would misread them. And, well, we won't call her pathological. No. Why is it that the partner seeks to prolong her pain? Because she's trying to figure out what the hell is going on with a crazy person. What is the source and purpose of this masochistic streak? There is none. There is no source and purpose. Predator, you were trapped. You were misled. You were supposed to misread all of the lies that the narcissist was telling you. Then you were isolated. Then they were going to mold and shape you into whatever fantasy image they had in their freaking head to get the most narcissistic supply. You didn't know what was going on because you didn't know there were crazy fucks like this out in the world called personality disorders, malignant narcissists, and psychopaths, at least not the abundance of them that there are in the world. Upon the breakup of the relationship, the partner, but not the narcissist, who usually refuses to provide closure, and do you know why? Because you want it. That's why. It's just another way to torture you. They know exactly what they're doing. Engages in a torturous and drawn-out postmortem. Yes, because it is a supernatural experience. You feel like you have been slimed. You feel like you have been sitting next to Satan himself. Because you couldn't figure out what the hell was going on, but the narcissist lies just good enough all the time to make you believe that you were in some type of normal relationship. You keep waiting for normal, but normal never happens. Chaos and drama. That's the smoke and mirrors. That's to keep you distracted from their pathology. So, isn't this interesting article written by Sam Vaknin? And he hardly ever, if ever, covered narcissists becoming codependents. No. He basically pathologized the victim. It's all her fault. Isn't that interesting? So, there was one other last thing I wanted to cover after that article, and I mentioned in my first video that I have a theory. A really easy one about how predators get into your life, malignant narcissists, psychopaths, narcopaths, whatever you want to call them, cluster Bs. Assuming that there's about 95% of us normies, neurotypicals out there who want to lead a good life, be good parents, do the normal things, work hard, move up in your company or your own business, and raise your children well, save for retirement, and all that stuff, right? There's a lot of us out there who, that's the game plan, right? Well, guess what? Pathologicals, cluster Bs, narcopaths, psychopaths, they don't play by the rules. Oh, they appear to, don't they? They look really good on paper, at least mine does. Mm-hmm. And they look really good in appearance. And sometimes their life is just a little too perfect, isn't it? And they say all the right things at all the right time. But they don't play by the rules. You do. So how does a narcissist, narcopath, psychopath, cluster B personality disorder stay 10 steps ahead of you? They know your game plan. You're going to play it straight. You're going to do what works. What works for most people anyway. They know exactly where you're headed, and they don't play by the rules. So, that's how they stay 10 steps ahead of you. If you're a neurotypical, normie, normal, empathetic human being. It's that simple. If you want to know how they're going to get to you, their favorite thing is a smear campaign. They can pick a lot of other suckers out there to spread their rumors and gossip to ruin your reputation and your credibility like mine has done. That can happen at a company, in a neighborhood, and in your own family. And they'll do it just for shits and giggles, and they most of the time don't get caught doing it because they like to keep their hands clean and manipulate someone else to do it. That's part of the game too. But there you go. If you want to know how a narcopath stays 10 steps ahead of you, you're normal. You're going to follow a simple game plan that most normal, what most people would describe as successful people follow. It's that simple. And as far as this article goes, Sam Vaknin just went on to pathologize the victim. Didn't talk about the narcissist's codependent at all. And this is the meme that's been going out there. Yeah, a lot of therapists have gone on to pathologize the victim, just like what Sam Vaknin did here. It must be unconscious. You are with him unconsciously. You didn't see this because you're unconscious. You provoked him. See, he wouldn't be so sadistic if you weren't with him. It's all your fault. Ridiculous. Absolutely ridiculous. My whole point is, of course there's this whole movement of heal your codependency, heal your childhood issues. That's the only way that you can avoid a narcissist or narcopath or psychopath in the future. Nope. Mm-mm. Dangerous idea. Because if you're going to walk around confidently thinking you are fully healed after going through one of these programs, and you think you are now immune to the next psychopath or narcissist, you are sorely mistaken. Right when your guard is down, that's when they come in again. These people are everywhere. They're your neighbors, they're your bosses, they're your friends, and a lot of times they're in your family. Yeah. So this was my whole point. I think I made sense. I'm not really sure. Please let me know in the comments section. And I will post this link in the description box below. And really, if you haven't figured out by now, most of my vlogs are about making you think. Because this stuff kind of ticks me off. And when people are misled and get hurt again, that bothers me because that's my number one goal, not to be misled and not to be hurt again, because I've had the mother of narcopaths, yeah, the Sam Vaknin, minus the 180 IQ. So I hope that helps someone today. Peace out.